Hello everyone and welcome back to Scandinavian Design 101. I'm Sanna.
I'm Andreas and we're two Swedes and we love design. Today we're finally gonna talk about the outstanding designer and architect Eileen Gray, in particular her masterpiece E.1027. And her iconic designs are today extremely sought after, and some sells for mind-blowing sums of money. In her later years, she watched the prices constantly rising and called them absurd. And she's a very interesting person, and we are, of course, going to do more videos about her. But today's episode is going to be about her first house, the E.1027, and let's get started.
E.1027 was Eileen's first ever architectural project. Despite this, it was very successful. The idea about the house came from Jean.
Yes.
Jean Badovici, her collaborator and lover. He was a Romanian architect and writer and had a big influence on Eileen's architecture. It was meant to be a house they could show to future clients and be a place for them to work and also rest. Eileen made a model of the house and Badovici proposed changes. Some she accepted, others she rejected. His ideas about the roof and staircase she did use. She shared the credit of the house with him and decided to call it E1027. E for Eileen, 10 for J, the 10th letter in the alphabet, for his name. 2 for B, Badovici, and 7 for G, Gray.
She began building the house in 1926. It was located at Roquebrune in the southeast of France by the Mediterranean Sea and close to the Italian border. She hired an expert on reinforced concrete called those names can be a bit... and he and his two assistants built the entire house. And there was no road leading to the location, so all materials was brought with wheelbarrows, so it was hard work. And Eileen also took part in this grueling task, and when the workers left for the day, she went for a swim in the refreshing sea. Yeah, sounds good.
Nice.
She spent most of the next 3 years in the area, but Badovici, on the other hand, did not have much time to keep an eye on the site.
Mm-hmm. The house came to be very unlike the rest of the houses in the area. It was in every sense modern, built on the basis of Le Corbusier's 5 points of a new architecture from 1926. The first point, it stands on pilatus?
Pilatus, yeah.
I don't really know how to pronounce that. Which means that concrete columns are used instead of supporting walls to bear the structural load. The second... It has a flat roof that can be used as domestic space and is reached via staircase. The third is open plan spaces is achieved by both freestanding and fixed walls. The fourth, the windows are horizontal.
Yeah.
It's kind of funky.
Yeah.
And the fifth, an open facade is achieved by the south window, which sets the facade free from structural constraints.
Yeah. The pilatus were painted blue, which suited the house maritime style. She used lots of white railings and blue sailcloth for deck chairs and blinds, and a flagpole on the roof, etc., all similar to architecture of boats. Mm. The house was finished in 1929 and consisted of 2 floors. The ground level was 150 square meters and the first floor was 110 square meters. So the house was not particularly large, but no space was wasted. The floors were linked by a central spiral staircase that also led up to the roof. The largest space of the house was the open living room, and it also had 2 bedrooms, terraces and bathrooms. Areas were divided by movable partition walls and screens. And even though some spaces were small, she achieved a feeling of space with the use of different colors, light and dark, shiny reflective materials, and mirrors. All rooms also had its own outside space, which also added to the spacious feeling. This also gave a sense of independence, which was very important for Eileen, who have said that each person must be able to feel alone even in the smallest house. Yeah. And personal space was the key.
That's kind of nice.
Yeah.
When entering the house, you are welcomed by a large entrance hall with a curved translucent cupboard that screened off the entrance from the living room. And on the walls were the words, I can't pronounce it, so I'm gonna show it.
Entrez lentement.
You see. That means enter slowly. And with these words, she told the visitors they were entering a labyrinth where many choices could be made. The architectural route was supposed to be mysterious. Eileen was very conscious about the first impression a house gave its visitors. The large living room was divided with screens and built-in furniture to create different areas for eating, relaxing, and reading. It was furnished with a transat chair, a large divan, hand-woven rugs, and dining table with tubular steel frame and a cork top to reduce noise. That's very clever. Yeah. Written on the wall of the living room was...
Invitation au voyage.
Yeah, invitation to a voyage. Eileen experimented with the system of different kind of windows and shutters that regulated ventilation and the natural light. Some windows could be folded back and pushed aside, and some shutters ran on rails, and it was a whole science.
Yeah, it was advanced.
Yeah.
Hidden behind an aluminum cupboard, which was also a screen door, was a bathroom in black tiles. The guest room had wardrobe with concealed lighting and glass shelving. One wall was painted green. Another had a wash corner with a mirror later called the satellite mirror. It had a lamp fitting in the center that admitted light without blinding the onlooker, and a small magnifying mirror on a movable arm. This is very clever, and it's a beautiful mirror. There was also a table that could be turned into a desk.
Not equally smart.
No, not really.
Because it's kind of the same.
Yeah, it is. But, yeah.
But well.
Yeah. And one room in the house was sadly underwhelming, and that was the kitchen. Eileen had no idea how to run a household, and food was not her priority. But she did have a great liking for wine, and who doesn't?
Exactly.
The kitchen was tiny, with items stored so high they could barely be reached. Luckily, there was an area for cooking outside. The maid's room revealed that Eileen was still a part of the older era, despite her otherwise progressive ways. She designed a perfect small living cell with only the basic comfort. And according to Eileen, the room could serve as a model for all servants' and children's rooms. So it's clear that in her mind, servants and children could live in reduced circumstances.
Basic.
Basic, yeah. The house was otherwise filled with personal and cheerful touches from the inscriptions on the walls to special places around the bed for books and water bottles. And yeah, a sand-filled pool in the terrace where one could cool or warm one's feet. And much, much more.
It's filled with crazy stuff.
Features.
Yeah, love it. Very important to Eileen was the furniture's role in the organization of the space, furniture as a part of the architecture. And this is very visible in all the screens, part walls and part wall and part furniture, separating two spaces. Mobility and multifunctionalism was key for a modern way of living. Some furniture were fixed into the architecture and others were light enough to be moved around. Tables could be pushed together and form a larger one, and the legs could be shortened or lengthened to suit the height of the one sitting there. And one example is the E.1027 table, used as a bedside table with adjustable height. Eileen, like many others at the time, was fascinated by tubular steel. It was lightweight, strong, and more flexible than wood. And it also looked and felt very modern. Her iconic bibendum chair was also designed for this project, made from chrome and white leather. The inspiration came from the voluptuous body of the Michelin man, which body is made of tires.
Yeah.
And this is one of my absolute favorite armchairs
ever. Yeah, it's lovely.
It is. it was, of course, filled with many other things, and let's take a look at them.
Yeah. The house didn't get much attention and praise during Eileen's lifetime. For herself, the house was a prototype, a research project for a modern way of living. She did not at all consider it to be a perfect house, only an attempt to solve all the problems that preoccupied her. She believed some of her innovations were great, others still needed improvement, and some could be discarded. And Eileen and Badovici spent their summer in the house, and they had quite a few visitors. Badovici's close friend Le Corbusier and his wife, and also the famous painter Fernand Léger. But soon Eileen's and Badovici's relationship ended. It hadn't been a particularly happy one, and Eileen moved out.
Yeah. Eileen and Le Corbusier were very different, and their relationship was distant. Le Corbusier considered himself to be a superior human being and thought he knew best how people should live. Eileen was far too modest for such claims, but it was clear that she admired Le Corbusier's work, but she did not blindly follow his ideas. It was also clear that Corbusier admired the E1027 he has described it as a house full of architectural sense, and he went back there again and again in his life. This became a frustration for him that a woman with no architectural background could execute such an impressive building like the E1027. And in the 30s, Le Corbusier had very little architectural work, and he got a new passion for wall painting. When Eileen had moved out, he immediately pressured Badovici to let him paint in the house. He wrote to Badovici saying, "I have a furious desire to dirty the walls." What? He's such an ass.
Yeah.
And this happened between 38 and 39. He started with the living room and then did an outside wall with three nude figures. And then he moved on to the entrance hall and so on.
Yeah.
And none of the men asked for Eileen's permission to do this. And her pure white house was soon covered with a total of 8 highly provocative frescoes. Eileen thought it was an act of vandalism, and I agree.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah. Dude. And in the 50s, he even bought his own small piece of land right behind the house, where he built a small house in timber with one window looking down on E1027. Hmm. And he later bought even more land and built 5 holiday cabins, continuing his invasion of Eileen's life and work. When Badovici died, Le Corbusier tried to find a buyer to the house that would preserve his murals. That was the important thing.
Yeah.
And he also suggested to turn it into a museum. By this time, the house had started to deteriorate and overgrow due to the war. It was an Italian military base, and the Germans used it for target practice. Mm. He wanted his friend Marie-Louise Schelbert to buy it, and the house was put up for auction, and Schelbert won. When Eileen heard about this, the deal was already made, and she couldn't do anything about it. She tried to get her furniture back, but for some reason she was prevented from doing so. The new owner didn't even want the furniture and thought about burning them, but luckily Corbusier stopped her and made her promise not to change much in the house. And so she didn't. The house was left in its original state until her death in 1982.
That was nice.
Yeah, that's a good thing.
Yeah. For some reason, the house was left for her physician, a Dr. Peter Keggy. Possibly, it's a weird name, I'm sorry. Yeah. And he came to sell the furniture at Sotheby's in Paris. 8 of the pieces were bought by the Museum Centre Pompidou and have been restored. The rest of the furniture were scattered all over the world. And some years after this, the doctor was murdered in the house by the gardeners. And the rumor was that he didn't pay them for the gardening, nor the additional and more sexual services. Oh. But it's not confirmed.
No.
The house was now empty, and squatters moved in and dismembered and destroyed it. The author of this book we read for this episode, Peter Adam, was close friends with Eileen, and he fought to have the house protected by the state. And since 1999, the French state owns the area, now called Cap Modern, which includes the E1027 and Le Corbusier's house, the Cabanon, and the holiday cabins.
Yeah.
The restoration cost of the house was around 5 million euros. Mm-hmm. And I wonder what that is in dollars.
That up and tell you here.
Yeah. And it was coordinated by a British businessman called Michael Leakierman.
Something like that.
Yeah. The site is now a well-visited tourist attraction, drawing around 10,000 visitors a year from all over the world. And it's also on UNESCO's World Heritage List.
Yeah, so it's protected and can visit it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And this was our episode about E1027. And it's a fascinating house.
It really is.
And as we said in the beginning of the episode, we will do more videos about Eileen Gray. Yeah, because she's extremely fascinating
person too.
So, yeah. But if you liked this episode,
please click thumbs up and subscribe.
And follow us on Instagram. We are called Scandinavian Design 101.
Yes, thank you for watching.
Thank you.